Hello, everyone. I'm Caitlin O'Hanlon. I am the director of the Wattpad Stars, and you are here today for the art of character and world building. In my opinion, probably one of the most important parts of storytelling. Character and world building and ensuring that you have strong areas of both in storytelling that is immersive is what can really carry a story and make it an experience for the reader. We have four wonderful panelists here with us today who write in four very different genres, who are all, in our opinion, really, really great at character, at building great characters and worlds. So I'm going to let them come up and introduce themselves. Ladies and gentlemen. We're going to start at this end.
Hi, I'm Mikaela Binder, same on Wattpad. The main thing I write is science fiction, so my main story is expiration date.
Hi, I'm Deanna Cameron, but I'm known more commonly as Liz from 1996, and I wrote books like What Happened That Night and Ella Was.
Hi, my name is Cara Barbieri, a.k.a. Pandian on Wattpad, and I'm known for my book White Stag.
And I'm Paul Kingston on Wattpad. I'm at Paul Kingston. It's really complicated. And I write horror, probably most known for Goats from Lambs.
So we are going to jump right into questions. We will do that for a little while, and then we will let the audience take a few, we'll take a few questions from the audience. And then at the end of this, exciting for everyone who chose this panel to be at today, we are going to give away two signed copies of Kara's advanced reader copies of White Stag, which doesn't actually come out until January 9th. January 8th.
Keep doing that. This keeps happening.
Erase that from the live stream. January 8th, 2019.
We're cursed, just getting the date wrong all the time.
I know, every time. So in your opinion, what is the importance of world building in storytelling?
I guess I'll start. So the importance of world building when you're telling a story is, I mean, in my opinion, is absolutely paramount. If you aren't taking the time to invest into the world of your story and the way that you're investing into your original idea and the way that you're investing into your characters or your dialogue, for that matter, if you're not investing into that world, then you're not really giving anything a home to exist within. Right? I know I'm kind of jumping ahead to one of our future questions down the list, but ultimately, I mean, the environment in which your story takes place, the world in which your story takes place, can be its own character. It can absolutely act as its own influence within the story itself. You don't have to look much further than like watch two people have a conversation in, you know, a casual regular kitchen versus a kitchen in an old home with, you know, like wilting walls and, you know, crooked counters and all that sort of thing. It will affect the characters. It will change the way they react with one another and the way they react on their own as well. So in my opinion, that's why world building is important.
Jump on in.
Well, I do it because that's what I want to read. I like reading books with strong world building, so I write them, and I notice that when I read books like that, I want to do that more often. And it's like little details I see in my own life, I think they're weird, so I want to write them in. Like how paint chips off, that's weird, but I put it in because it might matter.
I just blanked out. Shit. This is going to happen multiple times. Get ready. For me, world building is important, especially because I tend to write like high fantasy. And I like the idea that when I'm world building in a high fantasy, I can do just anything I want. And make, you know, something that's only in my head like actual living as Paul said, like character onto its own. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed doing that, especially with White Stag, because I got to, you know, incorporate myth into my own kind of story, and it was fun.
So I really like reading fantasy and sci-fi because I like reading to go other places. So if I can't picture the world that I'm reading a story of, I feel like I've been cheated out of what I came there to do.
Yeah. Great. So as I previously mentioned, you all actually write in different genres, which thank you for all saying which genres you wrote in. So who or what motivates the world creation in your stories, if anything?
When I first start writing a story, the world is literally what comes first into my mind, especially like the landscape of the story. Like, for example, in White Stag, it's the permafrost. It's this barren, icy wasteland. And you might think this is all coming from Nordic mythology, but it's also coming from my home where it gets to minus 40 degrees in the winter. And then now I'm working on another project where the landscape is a desert. And so I always see these like vast landscapes as soon as I start thinking of my own, of the plot and my characters. And other than the landscapes, there's always like three specific things that come to me. And it's the theme of the world in that the way the world is and how it evolves and interacts with the characters has a certain feel to it, whether it's like harshness of the desert or like, you know, a cold, barren place and how that relates to the characters and their journey. In the same way, I also envision color first. So these like really small first like snapshots in my head kind of direct the entire story, because that's what always comes first for me.
When I started writing what happened that night, it literally came, I had really bad writer's block. I couldn't think of what to write anymore. Everything I tried just crumbled, and I was like, I'm gonna give up. I'm never doing this again, no more. And then I decided I would write just random scenes that had no meaning at all. Like I wrote about a Super Bowl party. I described like the ones I used to go to when I was younger. And then if you read the book, you know that there's a pretty memorable Super Bowl scene in it. And that kind of spawned from just writing about a Super Bowl that I had went to a couple of times. And then I started writing about a woman who really liked to garden, and then that spawned into the mother having this weird issue with gardening. And it all just kind of happened like that, where I wrote random scenes, and then somehow writing about boring suburbia turned into a novel somewhere. I don't know where.
I really like the word spawned. that was on my head. I just needed to say that.
Yeah, it just cracked out of like a like the alien from Alien, just
chestburster.
Yeah, just came out like that.
They're called xenomorphs. Anyway,
I've never seen the movies. Okay, guys.
No, and then in regards to what inspires my stories, I would definitely say I'm a very visually based person, similar to some panelists from earlier in the day, as well as some things that we just heard here. You know, it's like I don't necessarily read as much as I think I should, but I do watch a lot of movies, a lot of TV, and therefore, and I'm also an actor in my fake life. I say that because it's not very lucrative. But basically, yeah, you know, it's like I've sort of grown up with movies and TV as sort of like the echelon of like art, in my opinion, right? Say what you will in response to that. But basically, I see things before I write them. And, you know, for instance, with Ghosts from Lambs, the opening scene, the prologue, for anybody who's read it, and for those who haven't, it happens on a street. Wow. but basically, yeah, it was just like the image of just this like twisted, this individual with a twisted mind walking down the street and just like disappearing into his own dark fantasies. And it was just this weird moment where I was walking home from work one night, and I just saw this dude walking down the street who just sort of irked me in a kind of way, just the way that he was sort of like looking at women as he passed by them. And that image just really stuck with me, and that ended up serving as the main inspiration for the opening scene. And the rest of it just sort of fed off of that. But yeah.
So I write by the seat of my pants, and thinking back on all my work, I don't think I've really understood the world until I finished the first draft, because as I'm writing, I'm having the characters do things and go places, and I'm testing different things out and seeing what works for the world. And by the time I get to editing it, I think the world is finally starting to flesh itself out. And I think I would like to be able to plan a world beforehand, but I think it makes for a very, like, it's very serialized. Like, since I write on Wattpad, expiration date, I had no clue where I was going with that story. So the world was not finished. I'm on the third draft now. World's still growing.
Great. So I guess the next sort of logical question, which comes right out of that, which is great, is, you know, in your own writing experiences, how do you each ensure that the world is true to itself and that it's true to the characters who live in it, and that it, you know, feels authentic and somewhere that is going to resonate with readers and with your characters that are living there?
Well, I mean, like, the first thing that pops in mind in response to that is basically writing your own truths within your characters and your world. And basically, I mean, I can't remember who said it earlier, but basically writing based on what you want to read, right? Because until that story hits the paper or the screen for that matter, I mean, until that happens, you're the only audience for it, right? All of it exists up here, and as the writer, you need to be able to sort of enjoy it in the way that you hope your audience would. And so, as a result, I mean, as long as you're writing what you perceive to be as truths for your character and what you perceive to be as your views of the world, then that's going to continue to inspire you throughout that story and keep it engaging. And as a result, you will find like minds that become your audience down the road.
I write young adult novels, so pretty much the world I build is the world that anyone can see. So I try to use that to my advantage. Like right now, if I were to write about this moment right now, I would write how I'm a little afraid of tripping over that and falling down and on my face. But you can also, you write about the weird, like I said before, the weird little things you see, and then you write about it, and then you have like five people commenting, "That's so weird, I see that all the time." Like, I think someone did a post recently on how, like, this wasn't in a book, but it was on the internet, on how if you ever go shopping with your mom, you give over, like, they say your total is like $5.69, and then your mom always shouts, "I have the 69 cents!" Writing little things like that, I feel like, resonate with people, because they're like, yeah, my mom always hands over 69 cents.
Yeah. My mom thinks cents are disgusting.
Okay, we can move on. So how, we're going to move, well, first we're going to go back to the question that Paul already answered, which I was going to skip over, but now I think I actually want to ask it. Do you personally believe that the world can be its own character in a story?
No.
Controversial. There's a lot of
we will talk about this
there.
Later.
Outside the building, 3 o'clock, let's go.
Why no, Mikaela?
So I was trying to think. I firmly believe it's no, but I've been having a hard time understanding why I believe that. The world is definitely, it can act upon your characters, but unless the world that you're building is full of like nymphs that inhabit different things, very, like, everything has a spirit, I don't think it can be a character unless it can really know, like, be able to make action, like, it needs to be able to make its own choices for it to be a character.
Okay.
Oh, do you want to go?
I personally think that any world can be its own character. I come from a very, very, very small rural town in Wisconsin. It's also very cold. As I said, it gets to minus 40 in the winter. And there's an absolute character to that town and the people who are in there. And I think that you can put that in writing even if there's no fantasy involved in it. Because, you know, I think every landscape, every kind of world, whether it's the city or the suburbs or whatever, can have this kind of resonant, like, feeling to it where it's almost a person. And I definitely think that when I write, I believe that my world is also a character, and one that does not really like the main characters very much.
I don't know if I would say that it's a character, but I think it's a characteristic of your writing. Like, I've had people say that your writing's very distinctive, that it's got a lot of description. And I think there's some people that might be a character, to others that might be a characteristic, where, you know, every writer has their own style, and if you read them enough, you can pick that out, what that is, and how they build their worlds, and just that might be a character, but it's also like a characteristic on how you write, and how you describe where the characters are and what they're doing. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm coming back to my original answer. So I do strongly believe your environment can be a character. And a big part of that might be the fact that I write horror, and horror is so essentially based in specific atmospheres and specific events happening around you that don't necessarily involve living beings, right? Personally, I draw a lot of inspiration from writers like Stephen King and Clive Barker, like the very, very, you know, they focus on the minute details in an obsessive level. You know, Stephen King will write three chapters on the color of a wall, right? But ultimately, I mean, it is one of those things where even when I used to teach improv comedy back in Toronto, we used to do an exercise where we would very specifically teach people that environment can be a character in a scene, even if it's just imagined amongst the players on stage, because of the fact that it sets that tone. And it will inspire reactions from the characters, the living characters. And so while it could be described as characteristics, I do feel it also plays a bit of a role, though, because of the drastic nature with which it will affect those characters and their decisions and their behavior within the environment. So agree to disagree, I guess.
So we're going to make a switch from world building to characters.
Ooh, yay.
That
yay.
Feels timely.
So all of you are really good at, you know, writing characters that are likable to their readers. But sometimes you also have characters who are not supposed to be very likable. How do you, two-part question, how do you create likable characters, and how do you create likable characters in stories where maybe they're the villain or maybe they're not supposed to be liked? So two parts.
For me, like, writing likable characters is not just about making them likable, but about making them flawed and still someone you'd be cool being around. Can I use an example?
Yes.
Okay, cool. I don't want to seem like I keep, my book. I don't want to see
that. That's why you're here.
Sorry, guys. What'd you say?
Said that's why you're here.
Oh, yeah, technically, yeah. Whoops. All right, then. So in my book, White Stag, Soren is one of the characters, and I really enjoyed writing him because he's kind of bratty and arrogant and little haughty. I can't say that word, goddammit.
Haughty.
And he's kind of just like a petulant brat sometimes, but he's also very brave and loyal and passionate and does care very much for the main character. And I think it balances it out that, yeah, he makes a lot of mistakes because he's kind of big-headed and whatnot, but he does have these redeeming qualities. And I think that's something that really makes the character likable, is when you can see their visible flaws, and you can also see how they try to make them better, themselves better, despite them, those flaws.
So this is something I struggled with a lot, because in Expiration Date, the main character, Iris, I loved her. Everyone hated her. And I was like, I don't understand, like, what's wrong with her? And as I rewrote the story, I realized her actions just weren't explained. Even though it was in first person, people didn't understand why she was making the choices she did. So once I went through and kind of emphasized why she might be making, like, a controversial decision, people really started relating to her. And then part two, I love antagonists in stories. I will talk to you about them all day long. So what I found is I need to be able to sympathize with them. If I can sympathize, relate to them, even like them, I'm going to like that unlikable, bad character.
In my book, there aren't really too many antagonists, but there are people that can be perceived as that. There is one character that, like, he's perceived throughout the entire thing as an antagonist, and then, but for some reason, I liked him. He wasn't likable at all, but I liked him for some reason, so I thought, I'm going to redeem him just a little bit, give him sort of a backstory that kind of explains his actions, and then after that, people started to like him too, and I was like, okay, we're all on the same page now. The other antagonist was one that wasn't revealed until like 10, 20 chapters before the end of the book. She knows what I'm talking about. And she, the person, I'm not going to use pronouns, was decided to be an antagonist late in the book. At first, this person was just supposed to be a like decent, neutral person who made a really bad, stupid decision. And then I was kind of like, that's boring. I'm bored by this one. I want to switch it up. I want to make this person just downright awful. And I want there really to be no explanation. I want her to be like Michael Myers. I just want her to be awful. Dang it, I said her. Crap.
Michael Myers is just misunderstood.
We'll see this at 3 o'clock later tonight, okay? And she, like, well, you already know it's a she. And she, I wanted something to shake things up. And this was an idea that came, and I kind of pushed it away. I was like, that's, no, we're not doing that. And then I was like, we're going to do that. And after that, like, before, everyone was saying that they loved this character, that they loved her so much. And I always kind of felt kind of meh about her. Like, she's there. She's part of the story. I don't know what you like about her. I mean, she's just kind of okay. And then they were on her side more than they were the protagonists. And I was like, I understand, ish. And then I made her evil. And then they were all like, I've always hated her. She's the worst. And I was like, I remember, you know. And I think that was what kind of made her likable to everyone else, was that they didn't know who she was. And part of the reason why they didn't know that was because even though she was the antagonist, she really wasn't in the novel at all. She was just a flashback mostly. So then they all liked her, then I made her evil, and then that was like when people started to dislike her, because before they had really liked her. And then I just screwed that all up.
You're a merciless monster.
That's the best.
I ain't saying otherwise.
When it comes to writing likable characters, I think we already sort of hit the nail on the head in regards to saying that they have to be they have to have flaws, right? No one person in this room or any room for that matter could raise their hand to say that they are completely flawless, and if they do, they're a liar. Anyway, but ultimately, I mean, like, it comes down to a matter of perspective. I mean, nobody is going to be 100% hero. Nobody's going to be 100% villain. Another thing I used to teach in improv classes back in the day is that villains never see themselves as villains. They don't go, I'm evil, like this sort of thing, right? It's like they are legitimately doing what they see to be the legitimate course of action. And yes, it may go a little beyond the traditional means of morality, but ultimately they are doing what they deem to be appropriate in that situation. And then the other thing to remember too is, like, even in the case of your readers reacting to your characters, you're never going to get a uniform response, right? You can absolutely steer their responses in the directions that you would like them to go, but they're never going to be a uniform response across the board. Me personally, I've always been a huge fan of the reimagining works. So if you look at, like, way back in the day, some of you were probably forced to read this in school or are currently being forced to read it, but Beowulf, anybody? No? Yeah? No. That gem? So when it comes to Beowulf, it's like, you know, it's the story of like, you know, this guy who comes to this town and he's this conqueror and he destroys this beast that's killing people and blah, blah, blah. But then you fast forward a few centuries, and I don't know how long it was. I'm not a historian. But ultimately, more recently, there was another book written called Grendel, which was the entire same story from the beast's perspective. And then you start to realize that this beast is actually, you know, a very a very environmentally related kind of creature, and that it loves nature, and that it's very sensitive to hearing, and it just hears all this like loud noise coming from these humans, and it's just trying to defend its own land, right? So there you have a classic example of a villain that is actually not necessarily a villain. It's just a villain in that circumstance, depending on the perspective you have in that story. Going back to talking about flawed characters, if you don't give your lead character flaws, they are destined to fail. Case in point, Iron Fist.
I actually have one more thing to say, because I finally thought of what I was going to say for the antagonist. But so in White Stag, there's not many redeeming factors for the antagonist. He's just not a good person. He's just not likable at all. But in the newest thing I'm writing, which is something I'm serializing on Wattpad called Ashes Come Dawn, not only am I like having the antagonist be by the protagonist for most of the book, it's something where I'm working on something where our protagonist almost becomes the antagonist if you in the way her character changes and is manipulated. And I think that's something that's really cool to do. And I just wanted to mention it because why not?
Awesome. So from your personal opinions, how do you define a fully developed character? Or do you actually believe that characters can really ever be fully developed? Are they constantly growing? Are they constantly changing? Or what do you think is a fully developed character?
I mean, personally, I don't think they could ever be fully developed, because I don't think any of us could be fully developed. We're always changing, we're always growing, we're always adapting. So same thing applies to characters.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Same. Yeah, same. The only time they're not growing is when the book series is over, because then they're not there anymore. I hope I'm not mumbling.
Can I counter that? Say something completely different, Deanna? I'm kidding. No.
Come on, we know you want to.
I don't really have anything too different to say. I totally forgot about the question now that I'm holding the microphone up.
It's okay. Totally fine. Fully defined, fully developed characters.
I've wanted to take my characters through development. I've had people say that they are developed. I've had people say that that some characters need work, and then I'm like, okay, well, I'll go do that then. And I've never felt like I was the judge of whether or not my characters are fully developed. Because to me, they're either going to be really annoying, or they're going to be the best kids ever, and you can't tell me otherwise. But then other people will be like, that one, why does he do what he does? You know, that doesn't make any sense. And I could be like, well, because he can. That's why. And then you have to think about it, like, okay, I guess he does need a reason. He can't just... I wrote this one book a long time ago. It was about a girl who burned down a boat. And then everyone kept going, well, why'd she do that? And I was like, wouldn't you do that if you had, like, a match and a boat right in front of you?
Yes. Yes, the answer is yes.
So no one ever invite Deanna to your boat.
I mean, I probably won't get on it anyway.
Okay, so I feel like this question could be relatively controversial with this panel right now, on the way that you guys have been.
Let's. It's gonna be fun.
Although Kara did kind of answer this question already, so what came first, the world or the characters?
You know my answer already, so.
For me, I hope I'm not mumbling into this, because I mumble a lot. For me, I already mentioned that the landscape is one of the first things I see. I do kind of envision a character first, though it's very much a silhouette of said character, because many times the character is shaped by what the world I'm writing is. So I would say kind of like they both come first to me, but in different forms. Does that make any sense?
I'm gonna blow your guys' minds with the only philosophy reference I have. I think it was Heidegger who had the argument of what comes first, art or audience. Because I'm looping it back to the same argument for that as character versus world, and I think they're both mutually dependent. I don't think you can necessarily have one without the other. I mean, yes, you could write a story that's entirely about an empty kitchen if you wanted to, but I don't think it's going to do very well, right? Similar to you could write about characters that exist within a complete void, and I did write that one-act play, and it did not do well either, so... but ultimately, yeah, I mean, I think they are mutually dependent. You can't have art without audience, and you can't have audience without something to look at, right? So yeah, it's similar with character and worlds. They have to exist together, so yeah.
So I pretty much feel the same way, but I have heard of people who just make up characters and create them and develop them, but they don't exactly have a story attached to them. So I guess in that case, it would be different because then when they have a story, they'll put those characters in. But I write in first person, so I kind of will have that first line of dialogue, or not first line of dialogue, just first line of the story, and it's in the character's voice. So in that sense, sometimes the character does come right before the world.
But then again, you could also have the other world where it's like you see the world and then the characters start to populate it. So, I mean, again, yeah.
It's a big chicken or the egg thing, really. Mm-hmm.
The egg came first because they came from dinosaurs.
Okay, meet me outside at 5.
Cool. So 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock. All right, cool. Great.
Okay. What are your, just as a closing question, you know, for people here who might be interested, what are some of your own personal best practices when you are creating whatever comes first for you? The world, the characters, what are your best practices when starting a story?
I don't recommend this, but get sleep deprived is what I do. I have insomnia anyway, so I just kind of am awake for all the 24 hours of the day, get super sleep deprived, start to hallucinate just a little bit, and then boom, idea.
That's how you write high fantasy.
That's how I write. I wouldn't recommend it.
So I haven't tried this yet, but I'm going to do it for like my next story that's completely different. And it's using a world building questionnaire. The one I'm going to use is 30 pages long with every single question imaginable. But if you fill out every single question, you're going to have such a solid sense of your world that it's going to feel more real than probably this world, honestly. So I highly suggest looking them up online. They're available for free. They're a great tool.
Oh, I've seen that one before. I gave up halfway in. Good luck.
Well, I mean, I guess you could kind of do what I did with that one story where you just come up with like a random image in your mind and you start writing that and then maybe it'll take off. I've tried using it since and it didn't work then, so I think it might be a one-hit wonder. But since then, I just, sometimes I like what he said, sometimes you just randomly see things and it gives you an idea. One time I got an idea for a book that I never finished, so maybe it wasn't that good. But I saw a necklace at a gift shop in Niagara Falls, and I was like, I'm going to write a story about a girl who got the wrong name on the wrong necklace. And it only went off for 10 chapters, so apparently there wasn't much to say about it.
I've had so many story ideas based on necklaces.
And they make such wonderful bestsellers.
I never find those like those little touristy things with my name on, and it makes me really upset.
Me neither. All I got is a magnet.
Lucky you, you get magnets.
Magnet.
Singular.
In the singular, okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's not, I don't have a...
You have one more magnet than I do, so...
Give me your address and I'll send a personalized magnet. We can go to the M&M store.
We will do that. We will do that.
So we're going to go to Paul.
Cool.
Sorry, Paul.
Still here. It's okay. White men have dominated long enough. no, but I mean, it's not wrong. So, when it comes to my own tips and tricks for inspiration, I'm going to be the least helpful person up here, and I'm just going to say that inspiration can literally come from anywhere. It could be a necklace or an argument over magnets. It could also be, you know, like looking outside and seeing something in the clouds. It could be, how many children do we have in this room? Okay. It could also be imagination obtained from outside sources. I mean, it could literally come from anywhere, really. And ultimately, the key is just being able to spot those moments of inspiration and being able to seize those moments of inspiration and hang on to them for every single ounce of worth that they are. Because those will be the things that keep you moving in the moments of writer's block. Those will be the things that will keep you motivated when you know you're sitting there and you're banging your head against the wall because you haven't written anything for 6 days, but you promised all your readers that you would get the next chapter out this week and all this sort of thing like that. It's just, you got to hang on to the inspiration. And for each person, it's different, you know? Yeah, it's just a matter of finding that inspiration and hanging on to it for dear life.
Awesome.
My sister once won a horror writing contest by writing a epic story of man versus constipation, so you can do anything. Yeah. Anything can be an inspiration. Yeah.
Terrifying.
It was actually a really good story. She won for a reason.
Tell her to put it on Wattpad. Okay, so we are going to, we are going to take a couple questions from the audience, and then we will do a raffle. I literally can't see anyone, so. There he is.
Hi. Oh, I'm going first. Okay.
Yeah.
Do you guys prefer to plan out everything about your world and your characters before you write, or start writing a little bit and then go from there?
I start writing a little bit and then go from there, and then usually get like stuck halfway through before, after arduous months of trying to figure out what to do next, I finally finish the novel.
Pretty much the same deal here. I'll have that momentary inspiration, which will feed the first like anywhere from 3 to 10 chapters, and then after that, I just run completely dry and sit down and force myself to spend 3 days writing a full outline, and then I go and finish the rest and go back and edit the chapters I've already written to fit the rest of that story.
So I contradicted myself. I said I write by the seat of my pants, which is true, but I also said that I want to fill out a 30-page world-building questionnaire, so it can go either way.
I did the latter. With my other book, if I had stuck to what I thought it was going to be, it wouldn't have become the book that I like now. It would have become this boring thing that no one would have cared about. And I have like specific moments throughout the book, not necessarily, like maybe in order, of things I know I want to happen, but I don't have the entire thing planned out, because if I had the entire thing planned out, my character would have never become evil and stolen the whole show.
Okay, I have a question about character. So, number one, how do you do bad things to your characters when you love them? And then the second part of the question is, if you're writing in a series, how do you develop characters over a very long period of time so they have to have their own like development in each individual story?
Well, the first part, the first answer is because it's fun. I'm like a god. I can do whatever I want to these people. And no one's going to stop me.
I can do it because I'm a merciless monster. And it's no fun to read a story about a person who has everything good happen to them and it's all okay. They win the lottery, they find a nice big house, they find love, and then they die happily in their sleep. I want to rough things up a bit.
So I do write by the seat of my pants, but I do kind of know where I want the story to go. So since I know what's actually going to end up happening to the characters, I know that hurting them right now we'll give them a happy ending in the end, so.
I write horror, so nobody gets a happy ending. But I will say, I mean, I can't really speak to the series thing because I sort of write singular novels so far. But in regards to doing terrible things to good characters, I would say the easiest way to get comfortable with that idea is to start writing comedy professionally, and then you will learn how you have to cut jokes that you love, and you will sit there and swear up a wall because of people making you destroy your own work, and then it makes it much easier to hurt lovely characters. But ultimately, I mean, yeah, all kidding aside, doing terrible things to good characters, if it's inciting a reaction in you, that's probably a really good sign that it's going to incite the same reaction in your readers, and that's kind of why you're doing it, right? So I'd just say push on through it. As hard as it may be to get rid of a character you love, kill them off. Get them out of there.
Kill your darlings.
Kill your darlings.
All right, so my first book was very naively written, and I had the idea that if I told it through first-person narrative, it wouldn't be a info dump, like a 20-page info dump. So my question was, how do you turn an info dump into a description?
So. With passion. No, but in all seriousness, going back to what I was saying earlier about Stephen King writing multiple chapters about a wall, right? It's not far off from the truth of how he goes into these detailed descriptions, but you can, whenever you're reading his descriptions, it's not like the wall was flat, it was 8 feet tall, it was leaning southwest, like this sort of thing. He goes into the descriptions of, the character of the wood, right? And it's like, you know, the wood, as soon as you impart your passion into those descriptions, then all the monotony of the exposition starts to dissipate almost immediately, right? If you invest your passion in that description, and more importantly, if especially if you're writing in first person, because put the first chapter out for today is written in first person as well, and it's one of those things where if you are describing something from first person, that's your character's views of it. And it's always going to be tied to passion. You could be looking at that wood wall right over there and think you have no feelings towards it, but guess what? We all have a point of view towards every single thing that we see, touch, hear, or smell, or taste. So use that.
It's a nice looking wall, I mean. I do have an answer. And for me, what it is to do, because I write first person, is instead of having the information in the narrative itself.
Paul dropped his cap.
I dropped my water bottle top.
Okay. It's gonna be like, who's laughing
Thank you.
At
Can we
me?
Give him a book?
Okay, back to what I was saying.
Sorry.
I think it's better that instead of writing the world building into the narration itself of your character, build the world by the way your character interacts with it. Like, I don't mean, the whole, you know, as you know, Bob, this is the moon of the 20th century, and now everyone will have to do the something doodly-doo sacrifice that we all know from the beginning of time. I mean more like your character's walking through the woods, and a tree hits them, and the character swears because in this world that they live in, the trees are, you know, sentient, and they like to hit people. Something like that versus, you know, everything else.
I do info dump. I just dump it all on there. I just, you know, I'm a mess, and then I go back and I clean it up. And I think that's easier because trying to channel what you're trying to write into a specific form, that just messes you up or messes me up. I can't think straight, and then I'm struggling to write the word the. So I just write whatever I'm thinking of, and I just put it all on a page, and then I go back and I'm like, clearly you were not thinking anything good.
All right, I think we have time for one more question, and then we will do a raffle. Oh, hi.
Hi. How do you create emotional connection between your characters and the world, or between the audience and maybe the characters or the audience and the world?
Well, I think everyone can relate to someone some way. Mm-hmm. And I think that we're all human beings, obviously, hopefully. If you aren't, then I don't know. But we all feel emotion, and we all have been through pain, and we all have been through heartbreak. We all have been through, you know, euphoria and sadness and happy things, too. And I think it's less connecting the reader with the character through the character's events in their lives, because you're probably never going to slay a giant. I'm sorry. I'm sorry to break the news to you right now, but you're never going to slay a giant. But even though you're never going to do maybe some of the things that character did, you can still feel how that character feels. And so I think it's very important for the character-reader connection to really root it in the emotion and the mindset versus the actual action.
So I have a really easy time doing this with villains. I don't know why, but I think what I key in on is the fact that they're still human. I give them like goals that we all want. I give them a love story that they care about, but they're the villains, so how are they supposed to get their happy ending? And make the readers like hate them and then realize they care and then take away that happy ending and then they're upset for the bad character. So
brutal.
I just go back to what we were talking about earlier with and similar to what you were saying just now, making sure every character has flaws. That's what makes them relatable for an audience. And then, yeah, basing the emotional reactions off of that history of flaws, you know? Nobody's going to be afraid of something just because they're afraid of it. They're afraid of it because of some sort of past experience, right? And if the audience knows that past experience, then they're immediately going to identify that that's going to be an issue for that character and almost see that fear before the character themselves experience it. Same thing goes for any other sort of emotional reaction or any other interaction between characters for that matter. And it, in a way, when you get to the point that you know your characters so well that you can predict those reactions or predict their triggers ahead of time, you can almost like go back to the godlike puppeteer move that we were talking about earlier and purposely place the worst combinations together, and then those interactions will just feed themselves. They'll write, the story will write itself at that point, basically.
Okay, well, thank you for all the great questions. And thank you to our wonderful panelists, Paul, Kara, Deanna, and Mikaela. They will obviously be around for a little while afterwards if anyone has any additional questions that they would like to ask them. And I am going to pull two names or two numbers out of here.
But did you actually put one in?
Same yeah, it's yeah. The tickets from inside your. So, first one, 3805992. I just realized that this is going to be really hard because you might be the winner of this might be in a different room.
Tis true. Keep drawing.
We're gonna gamble here. Okay, so 3805860. Well, someone was close. I'm just going to grab a whole handful just in case. Last three numbers, 993. Oh, guys, these people all went to the wrong panel.
Tough crowd, man.
Yeah. 990. Guys. 991. Those were very close in numbers. Just dig right down here. 808. Yay!
We have a wiener.
There you go. The books are signed, but Kara is obviously here if you would like to have it personalized as well. There's Sharpies at the back. Next one in my hand, 799. No. Literally two off from yours?
Two off. Mm-hmm.
805. Yeah? Okay. Did we get it?
Winner!
Yay!
Woo! Don't worry, I hear there might be more tomorrow.
And there will be more giveaways of White Stag tomorrow for anyone who is coming back.
You still have your chance.
Thank you, everyone, and closing remarks will start in a few minutes.